أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. كذب أصحاب الأيكة المرسلين إذ قال لهم شعيب ألا تتقون إني لكم رسول أمين فاتقوا الله وأطيعون وما أسألكم عليه من أجر أجري إلا على رب العالمين أوفوا الكيل ولا تكونوا من المخسرين وزنوا بالقسطاس المستقيم ولا تبخسوا الناس أشياءهم ولا تعثوا في الأرض مفسدين واتقوا الذي خلقكم والجبلة الأولين قالوا إنما أنت من المسحرين وما أنت إلا بشر مثلنا وإن نظنك لمن الكاذبين فأسقط علينا كسفا من السماء إن كنت من الصادقين قال ربي أعلم بما تعملون فكلبوه فأخذهم عذاب يوم الظلة إنه كان عذاب يوم عظيم إن في ذلك لآية وما كان أكثرهم مؤمنين وإن لهو العزيز الرحيم صدق الله العلي العظيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم إني أسألك وأتوجه إليك بنبيك نبي الرحمة محمد صلى الله عليه وآله. يا أبا القاسم يا رسول الله يا إمام الرحمة يا سيدنا ومولانا إنا توجهنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا يا وجيها اشفع لنا عند الله. يا أبا الحسن يا أمير المؤمنين يا علي بن أبي طالب يا حجة الله على خلقه يا سيدنا ومولانا إنا توجهنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا يا وجيها اشفع لنا عند الله. يا فاطمة الزهراء يا بنت محمد يا قرة عين الرسول يا سيدتنا ومولاتنا إنا توجهنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا يا وجيهة عند الله اشفعي لنا عند الله. يا أبا محمد يا حسن ابن علي أيها المجتبى يا ابن رسول الله حجة الله على خلقه. يا سيدنا ومولانا إنا توجنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا. يا وجيها عند الله اشفع لنا عند الله. يا أبا عبد الله يا حسين ابن علي أيها الشهيد يا ابن رسول الله يا حجة الله على خلقه. يا سيدنا ومولانا إنا توجهنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا. يا وجيها عند اشفع لنا عند الله. يا أبا الحسن يا علي ابن الحسين يا زين العابدين يا ابن رسول الله يا حجة الله على خلقه. يا سيدنا ومولانا إنا توجهنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا. يا وجيها عند الله اشفع لنا عند يا أبا جعفر يا محمد بن علي أيها الباقر يا ابن رسول الله يا حجة الله على خلقه. يا سيدنا ومولانا إنا توجهنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا. يا وجيها عند الله اشفع لنا عند الله. يا أبا عبد الله جعفر ابن محمد أيها الصادق يا ابن رسول الله يا حجة حجة الله على خلقه يا سيدنا ومولانا إنا توجهنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا يا وجيها عند الله اشفع لنا عند يا أبا الحسن يا موسى بن جعفر أيها الكاظم يا ابن رسول الله يا حجة الله على خلقه يا سيدنا ومولانا إنا توجهنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا يا وجيها عند اشفع لنا عند الله يا أبا الحسن يا علي ابن موسى أيها الرضا يا ابن رسول الله يا حجة الله على خلقه يا سيدنا ومولانا إنا توجهنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا يا وجيها عند الله اشفع لنا عند يا أبا جعفر يا محمد بن علي أيها التقي الجواد يا ابن رسول الله يا حجة الله على خلقه يا سيدنا ومولانا إنا توجهنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا يا وجيها عند الله اشفع لنا عند الله يا أبا الحسن يا علي ابن محمد أيها الهادي النقي يا ابن رسول الله يا حجة الله على خلقه يا سيدنا ومولانا إنا توجهنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا يا وجيها عند الله اشفع لنا عند الله يا أبا محمد يا حسن ابن علي أيها الزكي العسكري يا ابن رسول الله يا حجة الله على خلقه يا سيدنا ومولانا إنا توجهنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا يا وجيها عند الله اشفع لنا عند يا وصي الحسن والخلف الحجة أيها القائم المنتظر المهدي يا ابن رسول الله يا حجة الله على يا سيدنا ومولانا إنا توجهنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا يا وجيها عند الله اشفع لنا عند وجيها عند الله اشفع لنا عند الله يا وجيها عند الله اشفع لنا عند الله يا سادتي وموالي إني توجهت بكم أئمتي وعدتي ليومي فقري وحاجتي إلى الله وتوسلت بكم إلى الله واستشفعت بكم إلى الله فاشفعوا لي عند الله واستنقذوني من ذنوبي عند الله فإنكم وسيلتي إلى الله وبحبكم وبقربكم أرجو نجاة من الله، فكونوا عند الله رجائي يا سادتي. صلى الله عليهم أجمعين، ولعن الله أعداء الله ظالميهم من الأولين والآخرين، آمين رب العالمين. وصل اللهم على محمد وآل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ومولانا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين، لا سيما بقية الله في الأراضين. روحي وأرواح العالمين له الفداء. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. So dear brothers and sisters, it's a pleasure to be addressing you. At least right now it's from afar, but later inshallah we'll be able to visit the Al-Mahdi Center in person. Inshallah, Allah gives tawfiq. Brothers and sisters, I would like to offer you my sincere condolences on the martyrdom of Imam Jawad alayhi salam. We are commemorating the death of a true hero, a champion of Islam, and someone who is a role model for us, especially our youth. Remember, this Imam, he was martyred when he was only 25 years old. But as we look to the lessons that we can get from this Imam, especially for someone who is this young and this accomplished, it's definitely an example for all of us, of course, but especially for our youth. What I'd like to do is to mention a little bit or help us get a deeper understanding of this Imam. And we want to answer a question. The question that we'd like to get answered for ourselves, and inshallah, be able to share with others, because that's also a responsibility, that we introduce the system of the Ahlul Bayt, the way of the Ahlul Bayt, the school of the Ahlul Bayt to the rest of the world. Why is it that Imam Al-Jawad was martyred? Why at 25? Why would anyone want to martyr this young man? Because you see, he was martyred, and he not only was he martyred, in the same way his forefathers were martyred, and then his descendants were also martyred, as it is in the hadith of Imam al-Hasan alayhi salatu wasalam. He says, "Ma minna illa maqtulun aw masmum." There's never been any one of us except that they are killed by the sword, or they're martyred, as in they're poisoned. Why would this happen? What happens is we're going to find that there's actually, this shouldn't surprise us. First of all, they're all one nur, as we have from this hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, خَلَقَنِي اللَّهُ تَبَارَكُ وَتَعَالَى وَأَهْلَ بَيْتِي مِن نُورٍ وَاحِدٍ. Allah made me and my Ahlul Bayt from one nur, one light. We're all one light. That means they're all doing one mission, one cause. What happens is that Imam Jawad is doing what Imam Mahdi will do. He and all of the other Imams were all working to establish the kingdom of Allah on the face of the earth. And if we understand this Imam better, then we want to study his life as an individual who, we want to look at the Ahlul Bayt as individuals, one person who lived for 250 years. Then we want to see what made this, the circumstances of Imam al-Jawad unique. What were his contributions? So, inshallah, what we'd like to do are three things we'd like to get from tonight's talk. One, the idea of inspiration, the inspiration that we can get from this noble Imam. Number two will be lessons that we can draw from his life, and inshallah we can implement. And then lastly, what I'd like to do is talk about how we can connect and benefit from this imam, although we are so far away. And right now, even if we were there in Iraq, perhaps because of corona, we wouldn't be able to visit the imam in person as we would like to. So how do we benefit sitting over here so far away? We're here in the West, away from the lands of the Muslims. So what we want to do is, first of all, divide the lives of the imams into four parts, four time periods. And then look in the time period that Imam Jawad was in, see what was going on over there, what we can understand, and what inspiration we can get. So if we divide their lives, so 250 years, the first 25 years, and there's some smaller details that I'm not paying attention to right now. The first 25 years are the times where Imam Ali alayhi salam is living with the Khulafa. That's one time period. What did he do? What were the lessons? How did he respond to the first two? What was different with the third caliph? That's one time period, 25 years. After that is the time period where the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, they were temporal rulers. So the government of Amirul Mu'mineen, and after that, then the 5-6 months, let's say, of the government of Imam Hassan. So that's another time period where the Ahlul Bayt are actually, they are the rulers. Number three is the time period where from Imam Hassan, from the peace treaty of Imam Hassan with and Imam Hussein, he was Imam Hussein's imam. So him and Imam Hussein, that peace treaty up until the advent of Karbala. So that was the goal of the Ahlul Bayt, was to get power back. In the short term, the idea was that around the time of the death of Muawiyah, in the ahadith it says the year 70, around that time was the time when the Ahlul Bayt would have done enough underground work to be ready to wrest power from the Tawaghit. So that period was a time where they started that serious secret underground work. That's that time period. After Karbala, then the strategy of the Ahlul Bayt changes. Now, from the time period of Imam Sajjad alayhi salam up until Imam Sadiq, there was one strategy, but I'm going to lump it kind of all in into this one last time period. The Ahlul Bayt during this, so this is now the fourth time period. During the fourth time period, the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam have three important jobs, three important responsibilities. And then inshallah, once we see these three important responsibilities, then we'll look and see, how did Imam Jawad alayhi salam apply these three? What was their responsibility? One is they have to reteach the masses true Islam. By the way, these are strategies that you and I can be applying right now. They had to reteach the masses Islam. Islam as the Prophet taught it. True Islam. What happens is the people need to know both the fundamental pillars of Islam and the practical applications of Islam. What the practical applications of those fundamental pillars. So it's not just book knowledge. For instance, what is Tawheed? Later on, we'll see, inshallah, how this applies. What is Tawheed from an Islamic point of view, from the Quranic point of view? Is it just book knowledge? Is it just saying Allah is one and not two? There's not 365 gods? Is it just not worshiping a stone idol? What is imamate? These are pillars. What is imamate? What does that have to do with me? These are Quranic concepts taught by Rasulullah. What happens is, and then of course there's the details of the Sharia, how does it apply, the practical life, so both the fundamental principles, and then also the details of the Sharia. The point that I'd like to share over here is this. This helps us understand a little bit about the philosophy of the imam. The job of the imam is he's come after the Prophet. The Prophet came with these wonderful divine teachings. These teachings would liberate mankind and allow him to experience the good of this world and the hereafter. But it's natural that when someone comes with a new message, it takes a while for the masses to absorb that message, for it to become second nature to the masses, to be able to really understand how does this message apply to me. I heard about it in the time of Rasulullah. The times were different there. But then under different circumstances, How is my time different from the time of Imam Ali, the time of Imam Hassan, the time of Imam Hussein, until this message matures in the hearts and the minds of the people? So one of the roles of the Imam is that they are teachers. Each Imam is a mu'allim. He is the mufassir of Islam and Quran, and he teaches the principles to the masses so that it becomes something that is, it's second nature to them. It's a common understanding and a common culture. That's one job. Number two that the Imams have is, now that I have this ideology which will save everyone, I also have to work to have a group of the mu'mineen who are organized, who believe in this, and who are ready to sacrifice. Not just that it's book knowledge, I need some people who can take this risala, who can take these beliefs, and then in order to accomplish the goals of the Ahlul Bayt, there's sacrifice involved. Everybody's not ready to sacrifice. How do I train the people, purify the people, so they take this revolutionary message, and then after that, they apply it? Because Allah hasn't willed, just like for the Imam of the time, that it's going to be thunderbolts from heaven, miracles, mu'jiza, and then Islam just takes over. No, the people have to want this. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. The people have to want this. They have to desire this and be willing to sacrifice for it. So that's the second goal, is to purify and train and organize these Shias who've accepted, the Muslims who've accepted these revolutionary teachings. But that's not it. The third role is also important. What's the third role of the Ahlul Bayt, which again, Imam al-Jawad, he is responsible for? The third role is that Islam isn't going to save us if it's just a Quran that's on the shelf. That's not going to save us. Islam has to be applied. Islam has to be implemented. People need a political ruler. They need someone who can take charge of their affairs, who can tell them what to do, who can move them in a certain direction. That's what they're looking for. So this is the role of the Ahlul Bayt as well. La budda linnas min amir. The Ahlul Bayt had a political role, and the role of the Imam is to now lead the masses, lead the resistance, be the face, the heart and soul of the resistance to establish the kingdom of God the same way that Imam Mahdi will do it. So that's also the third role that they have. Now, because of that, you're going to see that the Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam had political aspirations. And this part of the speech, I'm going to actually try and share some points just for our brothers and sisters to be able to see what the contributions of this Imam are. You see, the sad point is if you and I get to know the Imam, just who was he, who was his dad, how many wives did he have, how many children did he have, when did he die, we wouldn't accept that for any personality. If I wanted to tell you about Gandhi, you would want to know, well, what are his contributions? Who were his enemies? What were the challenges? What was the social system like? Like these kind of things. We have a real understanding of the Imam in our case. And then we can take him as a role model. There's some people, because they don't have this understanding, when it comes to Imam Sajjad, salamullahi alayhi, he's a champion. A hero, someone who brought us back from the ashes. But literally, if somebody thinks he's the Imam who was mariz, in Farsi they say bimar, the sick Imam, maybe you'll feel pity for him. And of course, this might not even be something we express openly, but he's not a role model. He's, you know, he's sick, he's tired, crying, he needs help. That's different than seeing him as a champion. But that means we have to go and have a little bit of a deeper dive. So it's because of the political aspirations of the Ahlul Bayt, the idea that they wanted to establish the kingdom of God, that's why people would assassinate them. That's why each one of them is either the sword, maqtul, or masmoon, because of these aspirations. Islam needs to be implemented. My job is to actually rule on behalf of Allah. So what happens is, Imam Jawad, as we're going to see, was so effective in his role, the tawaghit couldn't even bear his personality or his presence for 25 years. That was enough. so effective in doing this. They couldn't allow him to live as long as Imam Sadiq salamullahi alayhi, and to see where he was going to. They knew all of their power had been taken by that time. And they will go after the Imam. So now, some of these lessons that we want to get from this young Imam, this Imam who's a role model for us as youth. And inshallah, I consider myself one of the youth. All of us, inshallah, we consider ourselves youth. Now, the lesson is this. The first lesson, overcoming impossible odds. Learning to overcome impossible odds. What happens is you and I, in our personal lives, we all face challenges. Maybe there are challenges that we don't share with others, but we're all going through tests. It might be in my personal life. It might be trying to get married. It might be in being in a difficult marriage. It might be dealing with long-term health issues. It might be now post-corona finding employment. It might be dealing with my personal demons. I'm working on myself. I'm trying to better myself. It might be that I grew up in a family that was dysfunctional. Maybe I'm breaking a generational curse. My family, they had certain habits. We're all from different families. None of us were born into the families of Anbiya. My family had a certain practice. I'm trying to break that. I'm trying to change that. Whatever it is, we're going through challenges. Sometimes our challenges seem like they're impossible to overcome. Everybody or everything around us is calling us to just accept the status quo. Be like everybody else. Live like everybody else. Why be this person who is really a soldier of the Imam living differently than others? Others, they've accepted, they're just living as normal Muslims. Why are you so hell-bent, for lack of better words, on this idea of being a soldier of the Imam, actively involved? It's different. It's a challenge for everybody. What happens is we all have these challenges. And for all of us, there's a principle that we have to keep in mind. We have to believe that God is on our side. When we have Allah on our side, the creator of the universe, who brought the worlds into existence, and he is on our side, as we're taught by Quran, then after that, the size of the challenge, how long I've been dealing with it, my mistakes in the past, none of that matters. As the hadith from Imam Ali says this, this is about the muttaqeen. عَظُمَ الْخَالِقُ فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ فَصَغُرَ مَا دُونَهُ فِي أَعْيُنِهِمْ. The creator is so grand, so great in the eyes of the pious, of the muttaqeen, of the God-wary. Everything else to them is minuscule. So God is so grand. Secondly, to believe God's promises. When Allah tells us in the Quran, when you and I were facing, wait till we hear about Imam Jawad and his challenges, when we're facing these unsurmountable odds, these impossible, there's no way we're winning this war, if we believe the second challenge, promise of God. So God is with me, second promise of God. God sees me as a champion. He sees me as capable. He sees me as somebody who is well able. Let me quote the verse, one of the verses of Quran that says this. This is Surah Baqarah, Surah 2, and verse number 286. La yukallif Allahu nafsan illa wus'aha. God doesn't place a burden on a soul greater than its ability. So God sees us as giant killers. Like Nabi Dawood, if we can believe God's promises, believe that God's with us, we're capable, we can, and we do our responsibility. Like Nabi Dawood, we can also be giant killers. It doesn't matter how big our Goliath is. Imam Khomeini, may Allah have mercy on his soul, he was like this. He was a giant killer because of these beliefs in Allah and his word. And then after that, implementing his responsibility. So now what we do is we want to learn from Imam Jawad. How did he teach us how to take on our greatest challenges? You're going to see that he actually took on some of the greatest enemies. I'm going to talk, inshallah, a little bit more about the tawaghit and the nature of the tawaghit. But let's listen to a hadith from Imam Askari. The enemy of the Imam at his time, there's two of the tawaghit that Imam Jawad faces. One of them is the clever, cunning, well-studied, well-versed, established ruler, Ma'mun. And the other is his brother, Mu'tasim, who's going to be the one who actually martyrs him. So what happens is, we have a hadith. And this is beautiful for us to take in mind and then to learn lessons from this. Okay? The hadith is from Imam Askari, and he says this, أَضْعَفُ الْأَعْدَىٰ, your weakest enemy, أَضْعَفُ الْأَعْدَىٰ كَيْدًا, the one who is weakest in stratagems, the one you don't have to worry about, the one who you're not scared of, مَنْ أَظْهَرَ عَدَاوَتَهُ, is the person who exposes his enmity. They show you their fangs. They show you who they really are. Think about someone who's trying to wake up the masses. Right? The weakest enemy is the one who shows you their enmity, who shows you who they really are. The one who's challenging is the one who's a munafiq, the one who's smiling, the one who's friendly. Now look at the test of Imam Jawad, and wait till I kind of try to paint this picture for us so we see what this young Imam did for us. What happens is, his enemy, as I mentioned, is Ma'mun. La'natullah alayh. Ma'mun is cunning. He's careful, well-studied, intelligent. And this man is a veteran politician. Who was he? So Ma'mun is an established leader. He was older than Imam Ar-Ridha, remember. That was a mistake from me. Imam Ar-Ridha was older than Ma'mun. He's definitely older than Imam Jawad, though. Established ruler. He was the father-in-law of Imam Ar-Ridha. He opposed one of his daughters on Imam Ar-Ridha. And also he's the father-in-law of Imam Jawad. He's from the family of the Prophet. Technically, he's a Sayyid. The Abbasids are Hashimis. Technically, he's a Sayyid. Was he seen as somebody by the masses as an enemy of Islam? No. He had offered he made Imam Ar-Ridha the crown prince. From the very beginning, Imam Ar-Ridha was someone who never hid the fact that he was an imam. He's the family of the Prophet. He makes him the crown prince. Now he's going to, afterwards, he marries one of his daughters. And of course, I mean, he has ulterior motives. He's going to marry one of his daughters, Umm al-Fadl, to Imam Jawad. So Imam Jawad, in addition to having this cunning politician who seems like a supporter of Islam, a supporter of debates, someone who had great reverence for his father, who never showed how angry he was, and never showed when Imam Ar-Ridha was martyred. He was not someone who came out openly, alhamdulillah, drone strike, I've taken him out. It's not like Qasim Soleimani. And Trump, no, this is somebody who outwardly is very sad. It's much easier to deal with someone like Trump when you're trying to explain the tawaghit to the masses. To say that Trump is a tawhut is a lot easier than saying Biden is, right? Someone who, Obama, that's hard for people to grasp, right? But somebody who's snarling, Islam is the end. I think Islam hates us, if you remember what Trump said. I think Islam hates us. I'm in Syria for the oil. It's easier to deal with than these cunning kind of individuals. So Imam Jawad is a young imam. He is maybe seven, all of these facts, remember, 7 or 8 years old when he becomes the imam. He's being watched by Ma'mun. And not only that, Ma'mun puts a spy in his house. He was summoned by the authorities twice. Once in the time of Ma'mun, he's summoned from Medina to Baghdad. So he's under close surveillance. They're watching him. They've watched his father. They've battled with his father. Now, what happens is, this imam who his father never stopped saying that he was the imam, he is now the like later on when you hear the story about how apparent it was that this was the son of the imam, the imam after. The Shias have no doubt. Okay. So now our question is, when we're learning how to overcome impossible challenges, how did Imam Jawad, 7 or 8 years old, take on the Tawaghit? Established, powerful. This is one of those rulers who was not weak. The Imam, I'm going to talk about his strategy, but one of the things I want to share a little bit about his political activity so we get a picture of what the Imam did. So despite those limitations, despite the spies being in the home, the imam, one of the things he does is he maintains contact with the Shia through his various deputies and representatives. So remember, we are now in the fourth time period of the imams, where this is the height of our underground Shiite activity. At the time of Imam Ridha, we had reached a height of, we were a strong organization. We're active, yes, we didn't have the opportunity for khuruj and qiyam, that hadn't happened for us, but the idea that we're active, we're all over it. Let me just mention some of the places. Hopefully we can kind of get a picture of the effectiveness of Imam Jawad and what he was doing. So the deputies of the imam are dispatched all over the lands controlled by the Tawaghi. So through them, he's coordinating the affairs of the Shia. He's guiding them, directing them. I'll give you some examples. He has deputies in places like Ahwaz, Hamadan, Sistan, Basd, Ray, Wasit, Baghdad. Baghdad, which is the capital of Iraq, we have a strong Shia presence. Remember in the time of the death of Imam Musa, remember how the people came? So we have Shias over there as well as those traditional centers of Shia strongholds like Qom, like Kufa, and of course, Medina, where the Imam is. That's not all the Imam did. He had given permission, so he's fighting these Tawaghi, but he had given permission to some of his top supporters to take various roles in the government. For instance, some names now. Muhammad bin Ismail ibn Bazi, or Ahmad bin Hamza al-Qummi. These are individuals who had very high positions in the government of the Taghut, but they're loyal to the Imam. They're not controlled opposition. They're not sellouts. These are soldiers of the Imam who are working with the permission of the Imam. One of them, a famous name, is Nuh bin Ibn Darraj. This man is a judge in Baghdad. Later on, he'll become the judge of Kufa. Other Shias like Hussein bin Ibn Abdullah al-Naishapuri, he became the governor of Basd, right? There's another, Ansistan, Hakam bin, there's another brother named Hakam ibn al-Asadi. This individual became the governor of Basra. So these are governors. These individuals, their names I mentioned, these two, they were sending homes to the imam, right? So it's not just, I'm a Shia by name. No. I'm the governor, I'm sending my homes to the imam. Even in Egypt, we had followers of the imam. So in Egypt, there's a man named Ali ibn Asbad. I'll mention his story later, but for instance, part of his story is this, that he's studying the features of the imam very closely, trying to memorize how the imam looks so he can tell the Shias who are in Egypt, this is what the imam looked like, right? And I'll tell you a little bit more about his story later. Another thing which the imam did, which was very effective, which was using poets and those who had the gift in the arts. So what happens is poets would come up with masterpieces. They could come up with poetry, let's say in praise of the Khalifa, or you could be someone who was working for the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, and now you'd come up with this masterpiece which introduces your imam in such a way that it becomes part of the common culture. Everybody's saying these words. Everybody, it touches the soul in a different way, poetry. So what happens is, if you look at the time of Imam Sadiq alayhi salam or Imam Baqir alayhi as-salam, if you look at the amounts that they would give to poets, you'll find that they would give modest amounts to the poets. At the time of Imam Jawad, when he's part of the court, he's part of the royal family, the amounts that he's giving to poets, you find are very different. He's giving very generously to these poets. So that's a little bit. Now, let's not forget our point. How do we take on impossible challenges? We talked a little bit about the situation. We see the political activity of the imam. What's the imam doing? So one of the things that Imam Jawad is going to do, and this is another practical example for us, is the idea of reteaching forgotten truths. Reteaching. I said that one of the roles of the imam is that they have to reteach the masses Islam. Sometimes someone is a Muslim and practicing and believes in Islam, but they're very far from the true revolutionary teachings of Islam, even though it's right there in Quran and Sunnah, but the person's not aware of it, so it doesn't ignite the person. Tawheed, what do you hear? Like the ayat of the Quran about Tawheed, and let's see the role of the Imam. So one of them that the Imam has to do is to do this, and sometimes we have to do this, to reteach the mu'mineen these Islam as is, right? It's a fundamental task. So Imam Jawad, part of the task, he's our first young Imam. He's 7 or 8. This is very important. He's our brown Imam, right? Because you remember the story and how, and some people even doubted that when they saw the difference in complexion, how dark he is, how fair Imam Reza is this even his son? Right? So a young Imam, dark Imam. And what happens is he has to establish, one example, establish for the masses how an Imam can be young. Imam Mahdi and Imam Hadi are going to even be even younger than he is. But Imam Mahdi at the age of 5, let's say, he is not, so let's see how Imam Jawad alayhi salam, he goes over reestablishing a forgotten truth. He goes over and he's a known personality. Because Imam Reza alayhi salam had waited so, meaning God did not give a male child to Imam Reza until he's in his 40s. People were doubting the Imam. They were saying unkind things about the Imam. Is he really an Imam? There's the Waqifiyah movement within the Shia. But when Imam Jawad is born, that stops the debate on imamate. Everyone knows who the Imam is. But now what happens is, how does he establish his imamate? A forgotten truth, a hidden truth. For the masses, so later when it's Imam Mahdi, even though people haven't seen him, the idea that an Imam can be young, he can be a child, that's already established. He's the pioneer. One of the ways that he does it is by referring the masses to Quranic principles. And inshallah, you'll see a little bit more of this later. One of them, one example. I mentioned there was a brother named Ali ibn Asbat. Ali ibn Asbat is the person who comes over and he says that I am coming to see the Imam. I'm going to go back to Egypt. I have to tell the brothers and sisters in Egypt, how does your Imam look? So I'm looking at the Imam intently, trying to study his features so I'd be able to describe him accurately. The Imam reads my mind and he's staring at the Imam. Then the Imam was sitting down. He quotes a verse of Quran to him. Surah 19, verse number 12. Ya Yahya. خذ الكتاب بقوة يحيى take the book with strength وآتيناه الحكم سبيا we granted him the hukum as a child. Quranic principle referring to the people, it's possible that I can have an imam who's a child. Before him, Yahya, Isa, how old were they? Quranic principle, it doesn't matter how old they are. So what happens is, remember, this test was a challenge for even for the, and I want to mention another point from the life of Imam Reza, even for the Khawas. One of the trusted companions of Imam Reza is a man named Yunus ibn Abdul Rahman. Remember the Imam, this is our first young Imam, our brown Imam, that it still hasn't settled in the hearts of the Shia. So after Imam Reza is martyred, our greats are sitting around. They're all crying. One of them is Yunus. Yunus stops them and says, enough of this crying. Until Imam Jawad gets bigger, who should we make the people referred to? This is a very important story. Riyad Mansal got up. He grabs Yunus, slaps him a couple of times. He says, and listen to the words he uses. He says, you've been pretending to be a mu'min while you were a mushrik? A mushrik. Why would he call him a mushrik? He says that, look, you're claiming to be a mu'min while you're a mushrik. If imamat is from Allah, then a child is like an elderly alim. Even rather, he's far greater. And if he's not from Allah, then he's like everybody else, even if he's 1,000 years old. And then everybody else condemns Eunice. What is being talked about over here? The concept of Tawheed, brothers and sisters, as taught by Quran. Tawheed in Islam, and I want to show you one of the verses of the Quran. See how Imam Jawad is working on us, how he's training us, how his staunch followers, his true followers, are helping to smooth this out in the minds and the hearts of the people. True Tawheed, brothers and sisters, is not just a theoretical concept. That I believe Allah is one, you believe there's two gods, you believe there's 365 gods, you believe there's a cow that's a god. No, no. Tawheed, according to Islam, is something much deeper. The topic that's addressed most in the Quran. Right now, let me go over and just share one point about Tawheed. Quranic Tawheed not only says that I take God as my deity, if I am to take someone else as a ruler, if I'm to obey someone in disobedience of Allah, according to Quran, this is shirk. Why did they call him a mushrik? He said, we'll have somebody else, we'll refer to somebody else until he gets big. Who are you to appoint somebody? Listen, verse of the Quran. So this is Surah 6, verse number 121. I want to share the Arabic of it, brothers and sisters, just so that we can kind of like pay attention to it. Allah says in the Quran, Inna shayateen, definitely the shayateen, la yuhuna ila awliyaihim. They inspire their awliya, their friends, li yujadilukum, that they might dispute with you. Now listen to the Arabic of it. Wa in ata'atumuhum, if you do ita'a, if you obey them, ita'a, if you obey, wa in ata'atumuhum, innakum la mushrikun. If you obey them, in disobedience of Allah, you're a mushrik. A mushrik. How different is this? How many people right now unknowingly are mushrikeen? By obeying, not saying they're najis from a fiqh point of view, from the Quranic point of view. What is the issue of imama, wilaya, and obedience of God himself? How are these two connected? The way the Ahlul Bayt have said it, that the tawaghit are the source of all evil. We're not focused on the minor sins. We're focused on the biggest one. And then after that, all the Ahlul Bayt have said it best. The Ahlul Bayt say it this way, that we Ahlul Bayt are the source of all goodness. نَحْنُ أَصْلُ الْخَيْرِ وَفُرُوهُ تَعَطُ اللَّهِ. We are the root of all goodness. And the branches, the furu, are the other acts of obedience. The wilayah of Ahlul Bayt is the root of all goodness. وَعَدُوُّنَا. Our enemy, aslu shar, the person who is obeyed in disobedience of Allah, who doesn't have permission by Allah to rule. This person, the taghut, is aslu shar. And then the wa furuhu ma'asiyatullah, the other ma'asi, those are examples of sins. Those are branches. But the real issue are the tawaghi. So Imam Jawad has to go over and reestablish this in the minds of the believers. Because from our point of view, again, now that we'll go back to our context. Ma'mun is someone who, according to him, he says, I'm Shia. I have shared this story other places. I'm not going to share it right now. He says, I'm Shia. He says, I learned to be Shia from Harun, my father. He makes the crown prince, the Imam Ridha is the crown prince. He has a close relationship to Ahlul Bayt, the father-in-law of the Imam. Wouldn't he at least be acceptable? He's very knowledgeable, very friendly, powerful leader. Would he be acceptable? No secular leader can take the place of the Imam. It's only someone who is sanctioned by the Imam, like we have the wali of the time, the wali al-faqih. He's sanctioned by the imam, by the teachings of Ahlul Bayt. The faqih has wilaya. He's allowed to rule. Otherwise, I just want to give one story about this and then we'll move on to our next point. So if you brothers and sisters remember the time of Imam Baqir. In the time of Imam Baqir, we had another one of these kind of tests. Imam Jawad makes this very clear. After Imam Jawad, it's very clear who the Imam is. In the time of Imam Baqir, there was a man who was called the Najib of Bani Umayyah, Umar bin Abdul Aziz. He had very close relationships with Ahlul Bayt, alayhim as-salam. He stopped the la'an of Imam Ali. He returned Fadak to the Ahlul Bayt. When he died, Imam Baqir said about him before he died, he said, when he dies, the people are going to be praying for him. Because he did justice, the malaika will be doing la'an on him. You can't do justice with stolen property. You can't do justice with stolen property. I want to make sure that, because I don't have you brothers and sisters as my audience in front of me, one last story from the Ahlul Bayt about this, and then we'll move on to the other contributions of our Imam. Maybe brothers and sisters remember this story from Imam Sadiq alayhi salam. So Imam Sadiq, at his time, there was a man who was known as Allama, very wise man, very great man. The Imam wanted to see this man. Everybody's talking about this. Allama, Allah, he's so great. The Imam goes over, and then somebody sees him, and they said, tell the Imam, remember that guy you wanted to see? He's over there. The Imam goes over to see this individual, and this Allama is over there, and people are gathering around him. They're so impressed. The Imam watches the individual, and he follows him. The man leaves the presence of the people, and he goes, and the Imam's still walking behind him. He goes into a store, and he sees there's nobody in the store, and he takes two pieces of fruit. This Allama, and he leaves, puts it under his cloak, he goes. Then he goes to another store and he takes two pieces of bread and he leaves. After that, what's so interesting is he goes to a house where there are fuqara, masakin, poor people, and then he gives away the fruit and he gives away the bread. Now the Imam stops him. He says, who are you? What are you doing? The man says, he stops the Imam. He says, who are you? He says, I'm Ja'far, the son of Muhammad, my lineage. He says, you're a son of the Prophet and you don't know Quran? What are you talking about? According to Quran, how many sins do I get if I do a sin? You get one. How many good deeds do I do if I do one good deed? According to Quran, man ja'a bil hasana falahu ashru amthalih. 10. So now you do the math, Imam. I did 4 good deeds. I gave these fuqara. And I committed 4 sins. 36. The Imam stops him. You can't do justice with stolen goods. No one has the right to rule other than Ahlul Bayt. If you do, even if you do justice, you're a mushrik. If I obey you, you're a mushrik. You're the problem itself, the aslu shar. So this is one example of who the Imam is and what he did to in order to train us. Now, next, Imam Jawad, and I'm going to go kind of quickly now. The Imam would have debates. These are very well known. Brothers and sisters can go over and look at these debates that our young Imam would have. According, again, Ma'mun would organize these debates. And the Imam would display, people would ask him any questions, ulama, scholars, thinkers, open discussion. Imam would sit down, debate with anybody, explain to them. Important point. Was this mental acrobatics? Was Imam Jawad going over and establishing for people that I'm a'lamun nas? So we could go over and say, alhamdulillah, he defeated such and such atheists. He was doing something deeper. He was establishing his imamate by these debates. Establishing his imamate by these debates. He's been introduced by his father. He was such a different color than his father. That made people again surprised. He was a baby, young, he was young. And his then after that, he's all of these established imamate. What is an imam? What's the difference between an imam and the taghut? These differences, the imam goes over and he says, how knowledgeable is the imam? He's connected to God. What else? Miracles. Another step of Imam Jawad. And again, you and I, what we're learning from this is Imam Jawad left no stone unturned. He left everything on the table. He fought with every means possible to establish the kingdom of God. And us, in our personal lives, when we're going against our demons, we're fighting our Goliath, the same lessons. So one of the, another thing that he did was miracles, which would again establish his imamate, teaching the people these hidden truths, making them understand who an imam is, what tawheed is. A man named Abu Hashim. Abu Hashim came to Imam Jawad and he told Imam Jawad this. He said, O son of the messenger of Allah, my father passed and he left wealth behind. I have a large family. He's telling Imam Jawad this. I don't know where the wealth is. He says that, look, please, you help me. Come to my assistance. Free us from need. Imam Jawad tells him, after Salat, I want you to send salutations, salawat, on Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad, on the Prophet. And after that, you're going to have a dream. In your dream, you're going to see your dad. When you talk to your dad will tell you where the money's hidden. So the guy goes over, he makes Salat, he does the salawat. After that, he ends up having the dream. He sees his father in the dream, and his father says, tells him where the money is, the money's hidden. And his father says this, take this wealth, go to the son of the messenger of Allah and tell him that I showed it to you. So the man comes back now to Imam Jawad, takes the money, and then he says, all praise is due to Allah who granted you the position of imam. So these are targeted miracles, miracles for a reason, miracles to establish imamah. What is the imam? How lofty of a position? It needs political leadership. Last point that I want to kind of share is how he trained us as believers to be ready to sacrifice. You see, brothers and sisters, there's one thing to be told that Allah is on our side. It's one thing to be told in the ayat of the Quran, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها, that Allah doesn't put in a burden on you greater than you can bear. It's another thing to see these things modeled, to watch an imam go up against these impossible odds and overcome and be effective, to see this behavior modeled. How do you teach people to be fearless? What did Imam Jawad do? One of the things that Imam Jawad did, and thing is, it's the sincerity of the imam. He was completely unattached to the dunya. How? He's from the royal family. His father-in-law is Ma'mun. He's living the life. He, from an outward point of view, he's giving large sums of money. He's able to do his things. Once, this man's name is Hussein Makati. Hussein Makati said, I went to see the imam in Baghdad. So I remember I mentioned the imam would be exiled from time to time by these tawaghi. I went to see the imam in Baghdad and I told myself, I'm thinking in my own mind, I said, with the food that he has in Baghdad, he's never going to come back to Medina. He's living the life over here. I think this in my mind. He said, Imam Jawad put his head down and his face changed color. And he said this, Hussein, the barley bread and the salt, that rough salt of Medina, of my grandfather, is more beloved to me than what you think, what you're seeing, what you said. So to see this model, I have nothing to lose. I'm not attached to any of this. My leader isn't attached. He's the first person. It's like the salt in Medina, the barley bread in Medina. That's one. Another one is to be fearless in speaking the truth. Sometimes you and I, we know what the truth is. And maybe we've had this experience where we know what the truth is. We know what our responsibility is. We could say something, but something holds us back. Sometimes we don't feel strong. Instead of feeling that inna Allah ma'ana, la tahzan, inna Allah ma'ana, God's with us. I don't feel that presence of God. I don't feel that strength that comes with having the Lord of the universe on my side. So because of that, although I have a truth to share, I don't share my truth. Imam Ali says this, Al-Faqru, this is about a normal person, Al-Faqru yukhrisul fatin. Poverty, need, makes the wise person, the clever person, yukhris, it makes him dumb, unable to speak, an hujjatih. Poverty, need, feeling weak makes the wise person, the clever person, unable to share their truths. Because I'm so weak. Because I have things to say, but who will listen to me? I don't believe that I have God on my side. How do we see this in the life of Mount Joah? How do we see this modeled? Not just that it's words, modeled. Imam Jawad at this time is around 11 years old, they say. He's in Medina. Ma'mun comes through with his entourage, that powerful Khalifa. The father comes marching through with his entourage. And when the children see Ma'mun come marching through with his entourage, children scatter. Remember, Imam Jawad is 11. All the children run, and then Imam Jawad is just standing there. So Ma'mun sees this one young person standing over there. He gets close. He says, how come you didn't run? Imam Jawad gives him two answers, logical answers. He says, first of all, the street is large enough for you to pass. You can move with your, why to go run and hide, you pass. There's enough room. He said, number two, I didn't commit any crime. Why would I be afraid? I'm running and hiding, the Khalifa's here. The Imam isn't afraid, not intimidated by the power of the enemy, how great they are, the entourage. They have everything on their side, not intimidated. To model that behavior for a Shia, so a Shia can slowly, slowly learn to be brave. Last point. How do we connect with this Imam? We're very far away. Brothers and sisters are in Canada. I'm over here in America. We're very far away from this Imam, and his name is Al-Jawad. He's the generous. How do we benefit from this generous Imam? All of us have hawaij. All of us have things that we need, things that we want. How do we get them from this Imam? As I mentioned in the beginning of the speech, even if we were there in Iraq, how many of us would actually be able to go? Who could go over? The Ahlul Bayt teach us something. This is now from the story that I want to share is from the son of Imam Jawad, Imam Al-Hadi. Imam Al-Hadi, one of the Shia, was living away from the Imam. And he explains to his Imam, he writes to him, he says that sometimes you want to tell your Imam the same things you would tell your Lord. You know that the Imam can read your mind. You want to share these things, you know, but we're so far away from you. I just wish I could be next to you in person. I could share these things with you. For us, we feel different when we're in the lands of the Ahlul Bayt. We can go over to the shrine. We can hold on to the shrine. We can pour our heart out to the Imam. What did the Imam tell the Shia who lived very far away, who didn't have access to the Imam? He says, in kana laka haja, if you ever have a need, faharrik shafatay, all you have to do is move your lips. The answer will come to you. The Imam is not limited. Medina, Baghdad, he's not limited. Brothers and sisters, inshallah, what was said and heard be accepted in the way of Allah. And we be amongst those true soldiers of the Imam of the time, people who are able to share these truths, these forgotten truths about Islam with other mu'mineen and the masses. Inshallah, Allah save the mazlumeen wherever they are in the world, whether they be here domestically. For us in America, the African-American community who's been facing that systematic racism for 400 years, the indigenous people of America who've been displaced from their home, the mazlumeen all over the Islamic world, in Syria, in Iraq, Bahrain, Yemen, who can forget our brothers and sisters in Yemen? What about in India, Kashmir, wherever they are, Palestine, under the rule of the illegitimate Zionist regime, wherever the mazlumeen are in this world, we ask that Allah accept what was said and heard in his way, and make it be a small step in the coming of the Imam by the right of Imam Jawad. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. السلام عليك يا وارث آدم صفوة الله السلام عليك يا وارث نوح نبي الله السلام عليك يا وارث إبراهيم خليل الله، السلام عليك يا وارث موسى كليم الله، السلام عليك يا وارث عيسى روح الله، السلام عليك يا وارث محمد حبيب الله، السلام عليك يا وارث أمير المؤمنين ولي الله، السلام عليك يا ابن محمد المصطفى، السلام عليك يا ابن علي المرتضى، السلام عليك يا ابن فاطمة الزهراء، السلام عليك يا ابن خديجة الكبرى، السلام عليك يا ثار الله وابن ثاري والوتر الموتور، أشهد أنك قد أقمت الصلاة وآتيت الزكاة وأمرت بالمعروف ونهيت عن المنكر وأطعت الله ورسوله حتى أتاك اليقين، فلعن الله أمة قتلتك ولعن الله أمة ظلمتك ولعن الله أمة سمعت بذلك فرضيت به. يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله، أشهد أنك كنت نورا في الأصلاب الشامخة والأرحام المطهرة، لم تنجسك الجاهلية بأنجاسها ولم تلبسك من مدلهمات ثيابها، وأشهد أنك من دعائم الدين وأركان المؤمنين، وأشهد أنك الإمام البر التقي الرضي الزكي الهادي المهدي، وأشهد أن الأئمة من ولدك كلمة التقوى وأعلام الهدى والعروة الوثقى والحجة على أهل الدنيا، وأشهد الله وملائكته وأنبياءه ورسله أني بكم مؤمن وبإيابكم موقن، بشرائع ديني وخواتيم عملي، وقلبي لقلبكم سلم وأمري لأمركم متبع، صلوات الله عليكم وعلى أرواحكم وعلى أجسادكم وعلى أجسامكم وعلى شاهدكم وعلى غائبكم وعلى ظاهركم وعلى باطنكم، بأبي أنت وأمي يا ابن رسول الله، بأبي أنت وأمي يا أبا عبد الله، لقد عظمت الرزية وجلت المصيبة بك علينا وعلى جميع أهل السماوات والأرض
فلعن الله أمة أسرجت وألجمت وتهيأت لقتالك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله. توجهت إلى حرمك الشريف وأتيت مشهدك أسأل الله بالشأن الذي لك عنده وبالمحل الذي لك لدي أن يصلي على محمد وآل محمد وأن يجعلني معكم في الدنيا والآخرة إنه سميع مجيب. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله الطاهرين.